Hey folks, this is Jake Davis with some old school wrestling for you. And this month I'm going to talk about WCW Halloween Havoc 1998. The show was held on October 25th, live from the MGM Grand in Las Vegas, Nevada. This is an infamous pay-per-view. Legendarily, the show went about 3.5 hours. The show had a lot of padding, a lot of unnecessary things that could have easily been cut, and talk about it as we go. And they ended up losing a massive chunk of their pay-per-view gate to refunds because the pay-per-view providers were cutting off the feed for the show in lots and lots of households. I was watching it live this night with my dad, my great-grandfather, and my cousin. Unfortunately, ours didn't cut off. I mean, it cut off for like a second, and we didn't know what the hell was happening. And then like a continue watching option, something like that popped up, and we just clicked it, so the show came right back on. The WCW had to air the main event for free in its entirety the next night on Nitro. It's a clusterfuck, but is also more than that famous for having... the worst thing maybe WCW ever did. And when I say the worst thing, I'm talking like the worst storyline with the worst build going into the worst match. It's up there with one of the worst in wrestling history. And on the positive side, it's also celebrated for having one of the legitimately greatest and most celebrated matches in WCW history. In fact, you cannot mention either man in the main event without fans instantly talking about this match. So let's get to it. Our commentary team are Tony Schiavone, Bobby the Brain Heenan, and Iron Mike Tenay. And all show I was missing Dusty Rhodes. I just don't like Mike Tenay. He doesn't seem to have much of a sense of humor. And he's just too... he's anal. You know what I mean? Mean Gene Okerlund introduces a card, doing the, you know, thing he usually does is. But Rick Steiner comes to the ring. Talk about his brother, Scott. They're finally going to fight in a no-DQ match later tonight. Buff Bagwell comes out, who had left the NWO the week earlier on Nitro. And he says he wants to be in Rick's corner tonight. Rick says yes, and go to the black back. WCW heroes never were that smart. Then we also get Nitro Girls. They were before Gene, but the Nitro Girls have four dance segments throughout the course of the show. I actually had no problem with these dance segments. It's only one of two times I think the Nitro Girls ever got a pay-per-view payday. I think the idea of cheerleaders in wrestling was a good idea and opened huge opportunities for literally every girl who has ever owned a Nitro Girl. And I say good for them. I'm actually surprised no other wrestling company has ever really gone for that since. I think it should have been spaced out more here because there's like four of them in the first half and then like none in the last half. So like kind of gets the vibe that they definitely had more Nitro Girl dances planned out for the rest of the show, but had to cut a lot of them, I'm guessing. I'm guessing there was at least one or two more that they had to cut for time because they were running way long on this pay-per-view. Show's about 3.5 hours anyway. And it's Halloween. It's not WrestleMania. It's not even Starrcade. It's Halloween Havoc. But it's a huge card. And also, I should say, this is genuinely, in my opinion, on paper, one of the biggest match cards in wrestling history. But we'll get into that more as we go. So, yeah, I really think the Nitro Girls thing should have been out. One at the beginning of the show like they did. One at the top of the second hour. One at the top of the third hour. And then one more right before the main event. That would have been a better way to work it all out. There's also promotion for a Conan music video that they're going to show tonight. Another thing they could have cut from the show because the WWE Network doesn't show it. Probably because they couldn't get the rights. Probably because they didn't also give a shit. But to promote the music video that they're going to debut on this pay-per-view. And yes, like I said, it's not on the show that you can watch now on Peacock or the network, depending on what country you're in. So we finally get to the opening bout, which is a bonus match booked that day for the World Television Championship. Heel Chris Jericho versus heel Raven. Interesting how these guys, yes, as I said, both super heels, both super over heels, one of the most popular heels in the business at this time. To be frank, very influential characters, both of them. It was weird they get booked together, but you instantly know, man, this is going to be a good match because these guys are very similar to the crowd. Instantly gets behind Jericho. Raven doesn't want to work the match. He's such a crybaby and such a spoiled sport. He doesn't even want a titles opportunity just because he wasn't told he had to wrestle today. So why the fuck are you there? I mean, I get it. It's Vegas. But, I mean, you go show up to your job and get mad because they got work for you? And then, you know, I have met people like that. I have met people like this. Eventually, they have a terrific match, one of the better matches of the night. It's fought very loose rules, but technically it is Raven's rules, even though they never announced that. But that was kind of like in his contract when he joined the company a year earlier in big promotional kayfabe. Anytime he wrestles, it's his rules. Anything goes, and he can have substitutes if he wants. He also postponed matches if he wants, but he gets goaded into this one by Jericho. Kanyon tries to interfere. He does hit... he gets knocked off the apron by Jericho. Jericho kicks out of the even flow. Finally locks in the walls of Jericho, and Raven taps out. Commentator's doing a good job pointing over here how Raven has kind of lost his heart since he lost the flock to Saturn a month earlier and had to disband. Good storytelling and character development for both these guys. It looks like they're developing Jericho for more of a bigger, higher up the card push, and they're definitely going in a different, interesting way with Raven. And spoiler, neither man will be in the company a year later, and WCW never did anything else with these guys. It basically, Jericho pretty much got benched shortly after he lost the TV title and didn't get much to do for the rest of his contract. Raven spent most of his time in the company being this whine, just doing this whiny thing, moping around, and then he came back in the spring and they tried to make up a baby face, and it just, by summer he had walked from WCW and gone back to ECW, which ended up not really working out for him. Jericho went to the WWF to become one of the biggest stars in the history of the fucking business. Hollywood Hogan and Eric Bischoff come out on the stage, and they won't really say anything while adding stipulation to the match with the Warrior. Hogan just really, really pushes that, you know, he's on a new level. He is willing to do anything. He took a chair and beat the shit out of his nephew Horace with a chair last week. He will do anything to beat the Ultimate Warrior tonight. Now, this would have set up something interesting if the finish to the match would have actually paid off. Up next, we have a match that they actually have been building up for a while, Ming versus Wrath. Wrath had been on a winning streak since he come back, and Ming is an unstoppable man-beast monster. Anyways, he's the guy they always point out, one of the toughest sons of bitches of all time. The guy on wrestling bios is his great thing, his manly meter. It goes as high as a Ming, or it could go as low as Brutus Beefcake. I actually enjoyed this match. It was pretty hard-hitting. The crowd didn't seem to give a shit too much. But, you know, Wrath was on the winning streak, Ming's a veteran, Meltdown, and Wrath won. Wrath never really did anything. It seemed like they're trying to recapture Goldberg's run in the mid-card, but he didn't have that phenomenal spirit that Goldberg did. We get, of course, a WCW.com online interview with Lee Marshall talking about Billy Kidman and the upcoming whole situation with the Cruiserweight title, and... It's always just like a blip from an interview, just a few seconds. He always throw him in there every pay-per-view. And I hated him. I hated him then, and the more I go back and watch these, I remember how much I always hated these things just coming in out of nowhere. If we're going to see a promo, show me a fucking promo. You know what I mean? Anyhow, up next was the first part of this whole deal going on with this Cruiserweight Championship. Disco Inferno versus Juventud Guerrera. The deal is the winner of this match will face Billy Kidman later in the night for the title one-on-one. Kidman's a champ. Disco has also had a lot of controversy. Has he actually made weight? Is he a real Cruiserweight? Doesn't matter because he's in the match now. This is a basic pretty good Cruiserweight match. The crowd is actually very into this one. Juve's a big face. Disco's a guy everybody loves to boo. Disco surprisingly wins with a badass. They called it the Macarena Piledriver. I don't even remember that nonsense. But it hits him with a really good leaping, like, I always like when they jump up for the Piledriver, not like the lazy fallback like Cactus Jack. Not dissing Cactus Jack. I don't want him popping up in my nightmares. But still, I enjoyed this match, and that finish for a Piledriver was beautiful. Up next. So he will be fighting Kidman later tonight. Up next, we'll get more Nitros, but I already told you my whole thing about Nitro Girls, so I'm not going to bring them up again when they keep popping up. Scott Steiner and the Giant and J.J. Dillon all come out at different times. Scott Steiner's talking shit about Ricky, then he invites the Giant on the stage, and technically the Giant and Scott Hall are the tag team champions, but, you know, anytime they get a hold of the NWO gets a hold of the tag team titles, they basically hold them, or any titles, they basically hold them hostage as long as they can, get out of defending them any way they can. And they're offering to put the tag team titles on the line against Rick and Buff tonight. Scotty basically just looking to get out of fighting Rick one-on-one any way he can. J.J. Dillon comes out and says, "The hell with it, then screw it. You're both in WO. The titles will be on the line. You're not the champions, but you will be defending the titles in Scott Hall's place since he's working a big match later tonight. But if you lose that match, then you're still going to stay here and you're still going to have that match with Rick Steiner." So that's the situation here now. We've added a title match to the show. Up next, Fit Finley versus Alex Wright. Not much here. Really short match. Alex Wright, Fit Finley runs to the ring post. Alex Wright hits him with a rude awakening, basically, and gets a kind of surprise win considering who was fighting. More Lee Marshall interview talking to the Cat, which is ridiculous because he's not even on the fucking show tonight. And if you're going to let that man talk, just fucking leave him alone and let him talk. Anyhow, then we have this special, it's hyped as a special challenge match. It's Lodi from the Flock versus Saturn. Now, these guys actually had months and months of heat. Lodi, Saturn was forced to be Lodi's slave, and Lodi was torturing him, and then Saturn won his freedom and beat Raven and disbanded the Flock. Now Lodi wants revenge. Another super short match, the shortest tonight, I believe, DVD, Perry Saturn wins. But what was bizarre here was this match was booked on the fly. It wasn't supposed to happen. Saturn was supposed to fight Eddie Guerrero, just like Alex Wright was supposed to fight the British Bulldog in the previous match. Bulldog's injuries had been mounting. Couldn't work the match. He just couldn't work. When it came time for show, Eddie Guerrero, for some reason, missed his plane or whatever. He didn't make the show. So I never understood the booking around here. You have two guys, both their opponents have not showed up. So, and we have a serious problem with the show running long. So instead of two extra opponents, throw them together and let them have a 10-minute match. Saturn and Wright could have had a perfectly fine 10-minute match. Especially since both these two matches put together, I don't think came close to 10 minutes. But this would have been a better use of their time, and a better solution to this booking issue that this whole show had. So now, already, we're getting to the Cruiserweight title match. It's like not been long. Like I said, the two shortest matches of the night were in between Disco winning. So Disco comes out, Kidman comes out, they have another long, good match, pretty good, of course. Disco's dumbass tries to powerbomb Billy Kidman, gets the fucking move, gets the shooting star. Billy Kidman retains the title. Of course Kidman was going to win the Cruiserweight title. I mean, retain the Cruiserweight title because, I mean, you can't put the Cruiserweight title on Disco Inferno because he's not a Cruiserweight. It just doesn't make sense. Which is so weird because a year later, a big part of Vince Russo's run with WCW was constantly putting the Cruiserweight title on these huge fuckers who weren't Cruiserweights. Like Disco Inferno and Alex Wright and Lance Storm, another big guy. I mean, he's not big compared to like the fucking Rock, but he's much bigger than guys like Chavo Jr. and Ray. But yeah, Disco eventually, and of course, you know, Ed Ferrara, he's not even a wrestler. His whole make was a whole parody of JR. It was very, very disturbing, and it was very, very distasteful. Anyhow. Kim and one. So up next, we have the whole Steiner family saga. Rickett, Scotty, and the Giant, the Big Show, are defending the tag titles, even though, as I said, Show and Scott Hall are champs. Rick and Buff come out together. Buff is not dressed to wrestle. Oh my God, I gotta talk about what Buff's wearing. He's wearing like a pea cap. These like ridiculous shades of like blue or yellow on the lenses, but the rest of the shades, the set. Got them over his head. Got a stupid chain on or something. Ridiculous, one of those adjustable size gold fucking Fletch watches. He's got JNCOs. He's got a FUBU shirt. I mean, he looked like a 1998 caveman. It's like, I mean, you didn't have to know anything else about the show. See, that image, that outfit he's wearing goes, it's 1998. You know it's 1998. I mean, wow. He walked out. I just started laughing out loud at what he was wearing. Because I dressed like that. Of course, it was. As a teenager that era, so I was definitely a douchebag. So this whole thing is ridiculous and stupid. As soon as Rick Steiner tags in Buff Bagwell kicks him right in the nuts and walks out. The referee should just thrown the match out right there. J.J. Dillon should have come out and said, okay, you lost by DQ, so you're still fighting Rick. And then they should have their DQ match. But no, Rick fights a full-length handicap match. The highlight of the whole thing is when the Giant does a missile drop kick off the top rope and misses Rick and hits Scott. Giant ends up eating the Giant Bolt, the Diving Bulldog, and Rick has won the tag team titles by himself. But there's not even a breath. Scotty is on him. The Steiner vs. Steiner match finally starts. But for some reason, everyone has forgotten that this match was supposed to be no disqualification. They have a good match, but the thing is they've been fighting each other throughout that whole handicap match. It's not like Rick and Scott could avoid fighting each other in a handicap match unless the Giant just did all the work, which he did. Buff Bagwell comes out, now dressed in a suit and wearing a Bill Clinton mask, and knocks out the referee. Just, okay. He gets meeting of the minds whole thing, another Diving Bulldog. And Scott Steiner has beaten his brother finally, and he is technically him. Buff Bagwell are tag team champions, but the next night on Monday Night Raw, Monday Night Show, he had asked Kenny Chaos, whose partner was part of a team called High Voltage, I think they were, but he asked Kenny Chaos to be his tag team partner, and they were tag team champions, and then him and Judy Bagwell were the tag team champions, and it was back to him and Chaos, and by like Christmas, just. Even WCW didn't know who the fuck champs were, so they just stripped the titles and they started like this huge 32-team tournament, which was eventually won by Kurt Hennig and Barry Windham in Super Brawl. So that is the very unfortunate story of the WCW tag team titles in 1998 and how WCW totally fucked up the feud of the Steiner Brothers. Two pay-per-view non-matches, whatever this double clusterfuck was, because either match was really bad, but the whole convoluted story of it just all really sucks. And plus, this was all about this was during the Chucky thing too. Fucking Bobby Heenan even at one point ponders if Chucky the Killer Doll will somehow get involved in this match. Not joking. And there's also and then they would have another pay-per-view match at the next pay-per-view, World War III, in another non-match that doesn't happen or have a real finish. It's just, they really dropped the ball with the collapse of the Steiner Brothers in storyline. I knew it then. It was the first time, I think, as a wrestling fan, I knew that they had wasted money here. They totally had blown it. I knew that, I talked about Dusty Rhodes before, but, you know, when it wasn't until, you know, later, it was right maybe in my early 20s, I started going back, seeing a lot of old Dusty Rhodes footage, started realizing just how huge a star he was, and became like, wow, they really dropped the fucking ball having him join the NWO. There's like 3 million great ideas they could have done, and they just did nothing with it. It's just an excuse to take him off the commentary table and eventually write him off TV entirely. That was bad. It was really bad. Anyhow, up next, we finally get our four big headliners. All four matches were promoted in the opening hype package, something WWE does like a lot now. Like in the opening hype package, they'll literally hype every fucking match on the card for WrestleMania. But, you know, WCW really would focus through the main event with this kind of stuff. But not for this one. All four of the final matches are hyped in the opening package, And that was kind of cool and different. I liked it at the time. But only one match gets an actual individual match package. And Scott Hall versus Kevin Nash tells the whole story of them coming to WCW, the Rise of the Outsiders, Scott Hall betraying the Wolfpack, Scott Hall's personal demons. And, you know, this video is already 20 minutes long. I don't want to talk anymore about... I don't want to get into how WCW really, really should not have used Scott Hall's personal problems that he was still going through at the time as a fucking storyline. Especially since WWF was doing it at the exact same time with the Road Warriors. And that was just as bad. Actually, it was even worse because it involved attempted murder. Scott Hall's faking being drunk, come to the ring, jumps Kev before the match, beats the hell out of him, throws a drink in his eyes. They fight, lots of brawl, and the crowd's really into this, but it's kind of a sluggish match. Eventually, Kevin Nash hits a jackknife powerbomb, calls for one more, picks him up, hits another jackknife powerbomb, and just walks away. This is never about winning a match, this is about trying to beat some sense into his best friend. And Scott Hall wins the match by disqualification, by countout, and walks away looking very humiliated. It's not a bad match, but again, this is a huge angle, and he just wanted to stretch it out for another pay-per-view, which doesn't pay off either. Eventually, thankfully, got Scott off TV by Chris. No, actually, no, they didn't. They never really, was it till March, I think, maybe. March or February, they finally let Scott take some time off and go deal with his fucking problems. Jesus. Up next is a legitimate bona fide fucking dream match. Bret the Hitman Hart defending the United States Heavyweight Championship against Sting. Sharpshooter versus Scorpion. Both guys are master technicians. Right guy is the heel. And it's just, I was so stoked for this match. There's a lot of backstage brawling and betraying each other, emotional mind games going into this whole thing. They've been hyping it for months. And I was stoked. And I still, actually, this is one of my favorite matches on the show, even though I don't really like the finish that much. Well, it's basically Sting and Bray. No, it goes how you think. They have a good match. The crowd is white hot. The finish is where everything gets screwy. The referee takes an elbow to the back of the head by Sting, I think, accidentally, and he's down. Then he gets superplex, and they land on the ref. I don't know how they didn't break the guy's ankles. Sting goes for a goddamn, and they always did this to Sting. They always did this to Sting. They always booked him to look stupid. He goes for a Scorpion Death Drop, a Stinger Splash, overshoots, and knocks himself out on the ring post. God damn it. Hate when they did that shit with Sting. Of course, then Bret steals Sting's back and hits him like four times in the throat, locks him in the sharpshooter, wakes up the referee. Sting's out, so they do the three-arm drop, and Bret wins the match. They stretcher Sting off, and there was never really a rematch. I think they fought a second time, but it was like part of a tournament. It was over a year later, and it didn't play into what happened here at all. Another huge ball drop. That's like, what, four on this show so far? Up next is the biggest match of the century. Mm-mm. Hollywood Hogan one-on-one with the Warrior, not the Ultimate Warrior. Why was the Warrior a face? Why was supposed to... He had been terrorizing and haunting Hulk Hogan. We could see Ghost Warrior in the mirror, and Hollywood couldn't see it, and Bret could see it, but Bischoff couldn't see it. It's some of the worst shit ever. And, like, in wrestling, ever. It's just up there with shit like Katie Vick and Mae Young giving birth to a hand, and the chick, the baby mama for AJ Styles. It's bad. It's bad stuff. It's some of the worst shit they've ever done in wrestling. And the match is awful. Clearly, these guys, there's a lot of waiting and stalling. I can't remember who did it. Somebody reviewed this one time and compared it to watching oil and water wrestle. That's just exactly what it's like. It is not entertaining. The crowd's trying to stay hyped for it. They go for a mercy lock, and they're in this mercy lock for like four straight minutes, and then they're like, never get the crowd back. Really, you can see people virtually sitting on their hands. There's some hope spots when, like, Warrior does, the real fuck up here is when we get to the finish. The Giant interferes, but he gets utilized. He gets him, you know, taken out by Warrior. Warrior goes for his shit. He misses the big splash. Referee gets knocked out. That's when Giant comes in. Hogan's going for something in his trunks, and he throws a fireball up into the Warrior's face. Or he was supposed to. Warrior sells getting hit in the face with a fireball, but everybody sees the fireball blow up in Hogan's face. They botch the finish. So nobody knows what to do now. Which is crazy to me, because this is when they get the crowd back, because Warrior starts hulking up. He starts doing his old Warrior stuff, running, hitting the ropes, the big clotheslines. I'm like, how is this not part of the intended match? Horse Hogan runs down like he's going to support Warrior. Eric Bischoff comes down. He literally just grabs the referee in a headlock to hide everything from him. Horse knocks the shit out of the Warrior. Hogan pins him. The match is over, but Hogan's trying to get some heat back, acting like he's spraying lighter fluid. He's going to burn Warrior alive. And they talk him out of it. And it's just, you can see, there's like a close-up when you see the guys all walking to the back. You just see the look on Bischoff's face. You know, he is pissed. He is pissed at all of this. And now it's time for the main event. One of the best matches of WCW history. One of my personal favorite all-time main events. In my opinion, maybe the best babyface versus babyface match ever. Definitely one of them. It is Goldberg versus Diamond Dallas Page. Goldberg, undefeated world heavyweight champion. Diamond Dallas Page had earned this championship. The people's champion. I mean, I can't say much about it. I mean, I could literally just about break down this whole thing for you. Early power game. DDP gets shoved out to the outside when he tries to match power and a collar and elbow with Goldberg. He tries to knock Goldberg's feet out from him, but Goldberg does like a backflip, you know? He does like a handstand backflip. Goldberg goes for a hip toss and DDP reverses it into a DDT in midair. Goldberg goes for the spear into the corner. DDP does a backflip, rolling out of the ring over the top rope. Goldberg hits the shoulder into the ring post, and both men fall to the floor. Goldberg finally hits a spear on Page back in the ring. Goes for the jackhammer. Page spins back around, hits with the diamond cutter. Beautiful, but he bounces away from Goldberg. He's too close. He has a scratch. Hits the crawl. Finally gets to Goldberg. 1-2. Goldberg kicks out. Completely out of ideas and not thinking clearly. He goes for a suplex on Goldberg. Goldberg reverses it with his power, gets him up with a diamond jackhammer, and bang! Goldberg retains the World Heavyweight Championship in an instant and bona fide fucking classic. The best match Goldberg ever had, and one of Page's best as well. I personally put the matches he had with guys like Randy Savage and Sting up there higher as far as overall, you know, build, style. They're just bigger, better matches, but this was an emotional feel-good. Just watch these two guys, two homegrown WCW stars, go out there and steal a fucking show. It was fucking great. It was absolutely phenomenal. And it was damn near wasn't even the main event. They almost ended the show with Hogan and Warrior. Can you imagine that? But after the match, Goldberg helps Page up. The men show each respect, you know, shake hands. Goldberg goes to the back. Page goes to the back while Goldberg celebrates. And, yeah, man. For me as a kid, it made me forget about all the stupid other shit. I thought the Hogan-Warrior match was bad, but I was happy that just Hogan won. Because I hated Warrior more. Anyhow, I know it's an embarrassment, but it's worth watching just to see this kind of how, with a shitload of money, a massive fan base, and the best roster you can ask for, you can still fuck up a show, and like everything can go against you. Just, you know, you cannot ever, ever possibly over-strategize. Especially, seems like when you're working with stuff like live television and fire. Anyhow, hope y'all enjoyed this video. Still went long as hell. I didn't want to. Anyhow, I'm Jake Davis. Catch you on the fly. Oh, next month, Survivor Series.